You talked in this video about a peace treaty. In your mind, why is that so important at this point? Can you kind of explain to some of the people who may not have that background?
Well, number one, it takes war off the table. I mean, we know in the year of fire and fury, where Trump totally threatened to destroy North Korea, that the Congressional Research Service said that in the moment of outbreak of conflict, 300,000 people would be killed. And yes, contrary to Lindsey Graham, those people over there, yes, it would be Korean people, but it's also 30,000 U.S. troops on 60 bases in South Korea. And we have a defense treaty with the ROK. And so the U.S. would be drawn into a long and protracted war. But that's just the minimum. If nuclear weapons were used, 25 million people would be impacted. So we need to take war off the table. Number two, like I've said, and Joe, I love you for, like, you know, using this talking point. The Korea peace train has left the station. As Secretary Perry has said, the North and South have begun the amazing and important process of normalization. Number three, maximum pressure. As you said, Phil, the last 18 years, maximum pressure, which is dressed up and a harsher version of strategic patience, hello, it hasn't worked. And this new, like, returning back to the rhetoric of maximum pressure, cutting off humanitarian aid to North Korea, preventing, because of the U.S. travel ban, longstanding U.S. American humanitarian NGOs from sending medical aid, you know, doing the things that would improve the conditions of North Korean vulnerable people. I mean, this is insanity. This is insanity. It doesn't work. And so our best hope, as Secretary Perry has said, as Jimmy Carter told me, as Sig Hecker has said, we need a peace agreement. We need to establish trust and build a relationship that would ultimately lead to North Korea giving up their nuclear weapons. And then finally, we have an ethical and moral responsibility as Americans to end this war. We don't know this, Americans don't know this, but the United States and Russia divided Korea. Korea was under Japanese occupation. My parents were born and lived in that period of colonial occupation. They couldn't speak Korean. They had to take Japanese names. You know, it was a harsh period. And when the U.S. landed in Korea, when General Hodge took over the southern part of the DMZ, of the 38th parallel, we put into power, we installed a military government, we put into power that the people that had collaborated with the Japanese and quashed the pro-democracy movements, the movements that were challenging the division and military occupation. We don't have a very beautiful history on the Korean Peninsula. I hate to tell you that. And so we have a responsibility. Signing a peace agreement would be the first step to achieving reconciliation with North Korea. And lastly, Adam Smith was saying, oh, you know, North Korea is using the nuclear weapon as a deterrent because look at what they did to, look what we've done to Libya or Iraq. Well, frankly, look at what the U.S. indiscriminate bombing did to North Korea during the Korean War. We leveled 80% of North Korea. So you think that Libya or Iraq is in their DNA? No, their own experience of surviving. They have a bombshell mindset. That is this history that nobody is willing to talk about, but we have to do it. We have a responsibility to end this war.
Okay. So, Lara, understanding the notion of peace, rivalries, history, I think some of our guests here who are from out of town would like you, I think would be more interested to hear from you a little bit more about the rivalry between Saudi Arabia and Iran, and you know, how this is affecting the dynamic, and then maybe you can talk a little bit, as we talked about Turkey and the larger relationships, so those power dynamics.
Sure, and I want to make a mental note to never follow you on any panel.
I was thinking the same
I want to, yeah, I want to be in the audience listening and applauding. And I wish that I felt such sort of passion because of some sort of optimism for the subjects I work on. I don't. Working in the Middle East just tears that out of you. You know, look.
Stick around with us. You'll have a little more optimism and hope in what we're doing.
Or don't stick around with me, or I'll erode that. And so, and we can talk about the the possibilities you want to talk later for the possibility for conflict in the Middle East.